investigate some of the greatest pioneering journeys on Earth.
All my life, I've been inspired by explorers and heroes who've achieved greatness in the face of overwhelming odds. Now it's my burning ambition to retrace their epic adventures. Relive their life and death decisions and understand just how they manage the seemingly impossible.
From the heart of Africa to the deepest Amazon, I'm going to fulfill a lifelong dream by experiencing firsthand the defining moments of some of the toughest expeditions ever undertaken.
Families trekked across some of the world's most brutal terrain on the California Gold Rush. I've always wondered how they survived.
The 49ers had, there's no map, no knowledge of anything being out here, and no one supporting them at all.
One of the bravest 1849ers was William Manley. Manley was just 29 years old, a skilled hunter who wanted to make it rich. The accounts of his journey west are truly inspiring. Manley emerged a hero, leading a legendary rescue mission out of Death Valley.
I'm heading west that way to investigate the toughest moments of the Death Valley 49ers' epic journey to the goldfields of California.
The California Gold Rush was the greatest mass migration in American history. Tens of thousands took on a four-month slog along the California Trail. But William Manley and six brave companions went looking for a shortcut down the mighty Green River. This is the first defining moment of Manley's unique expedition. He set out on the river with no knowledge of what lay ahead. Now I want to find out exactly how that feels.
Lots of wood. Whether I can make it into raft, I'm not sure.
Manley's crew floated down the Green River on whatever they could find. I'll be making do with driftwood.
It's actually pretty light and pretty buoyant, so hopefully it'll create a nice little sort of platform that I can then easily navigate down. So I've got six big logs, so I'm going to lash them in pairs.
The rafts in the pioneers' drawings look strong and buoyant, but this river still claimed many lives. I need to make sure my raft will survive the rapids, or my journey will end in disaster.
Every single knot is a weak point. Any one of those weak points can come apart down here.
The 49ers were totally alone as they set off on this then unmapped river. I'm determined to experience the pioneering spirit for myself. The rafting guide Brett Satir will intervene if my life's at risk in the rapids.
So when the 49ers came down, they really didn't know what was coming.
As far as being able to determine what sections were the worst sections, most whitewater, there was little information out there. But when you start getting into these canyons here, then you'd start to wonder like, okay, well, things are going to get more challenging.
It's taken 5 hours and a lot more than 6 logs to build my cottonwood raft. I have no idea if it's strong enough to carry me down this treacherous river. I'm an Olympic rowing champion. I should be doing better than this, but my raft building skills are letting me down.
Thank you. 49ers had to adapt to survive. I need to learn fast if I'm going to make it down the river. It's not the most comfortable. It's not the best paddling position. At last, I'm on my way. I'm in a tricky position of not being that confident at moving. My raft's still unstable, but the 49ers had to take chances on the river, and so will I. Good thing is I'm in the sun at least. If the river stayed this calm, the 49ers could have drifted all the way to California. But the current's getting stronger. Walton was swept into these same waters. He survived, but hundreds of pioneers drowned during the gold rush. It's way colder than I expected, but I can't go back. The only way forward is downstream. But my rafting guide Brett has pulled me off the river. In 1849, his ancestors, the native Ute Indians, put a stop to Manly's river journey here with a warning that saved his life.
So the 49ers, as they were coming down the river, encountered Chief Wakara, Chief of the Utes at that point. He did create a type of rock canyon to help indicate what types of features they might encounter in the canyon below. And in places, you know, the canyon reaches, you know, 5,000 feet deeper than the Grand Canyon. By going downstream, he knew that these guys wouldn't last.
The river was no shortcut to gold. Manly's crew were now hundreds of kilometers off course.
I'm not a survival expert by any means. It's a case of staying positive and making another significant step towards really understanding what these guys went through and mirroring it as well.
Manly and his group needed a route back to the Gold Rush Trail, but their immediate concern was finding something to eat. I'm about to find out how it feels to kill and then butcher my own food.
It was over 500 yards away, so it was too far for a shot.
Manly was a skilled hunter. For me, this is a first. I'm James Cracknell, investigating the courageous journeys of the California Gold Rush pioneers. Thousands of ordinary families trekked thousands of miles across uncharted America, creating heroes like 29-year-old William Manley. Manley's rafting shortcut through the dead end as he moved slowly west towards California, hunting for food became a matter of life and death. I've come from the Green River following in the footsteps of the 49ers, but I'm not just following in their footsteps, I'm going through what they went through, and that includes catching and eating my own food. These pioneering families had to work out how to survive in the wild. I need to learn some of those vital skills. In the mid-19th century, millions of elk roamed the mountains of the American West. For the 49ers, taking just one would sustain them for a week.
This is where they write the wall in the mud.
Stalking expert Travis Roundy will give me tracking advice. But for the first time in my life, I'll pull the trigger myself. It's elk season. A bull elk offers far more meat than I can eat. I need to find a smaller cow.
You can smell the bull elk. We definitely had a bull in this area.
Okay.
And so that means that where there's a bull is, there's a cow?
There's a good chance the cows have been here because it's mating season. And the bulls will stay close to the cows.
And hopefully see the cows before we disturb them.
William Manley carried a muzzle-loading rifle, accurate up to 200 meters. He was an experienced hunter and a crack shot. I'm neither.
It's that flick from 0 to 100 miles an hour. I'm gonna struggle with that, and also aiming and shooting accurately. The first bullet I fired ever in anger.
So even the odds, I'm using a rifle with more than 3 times the accuracy. Today, millions of American hunters shoot game animals for meat, but I've never done this before.
When we do see one, I've got to hit it, because even if you do a practice shot, you're going to scare them away, and then they may never show their head at all. Travis really has a lot of confidence in me.
After 2 hours of stalking, I've seen nothing. Travis is trying to draw the cows into the open.
That's what the cows say. That's how they talk to each other.
This is the first time I've fired a gun in anger. So I need to just make sure I'm focusing on aiming in the right place so that it kills them quickly, efficiently, and painlessly as possible. That's my...
Well, and the other way to look at it is if you were really hunting to survive for food and you got your chance and missed it and let it go, your family goes hungry. You go hungry for another day or two.
That's also true.
Grace.
feet of stalking. I only get one shot. Especially for how far it was. I ranged it.
Oh yeah.
251 yards.
We have to use the beautiful animal for the right way.
That's correct. The work begins now.
Yeah.
Well, that's good.
Emotionally, this is way tougher than I thought it would be. The 49ers had no choice. They needed the meat, but also the hide to make clothes, moccasins, and rope. They had to learn to live off the land, or they'd die.
That's what I think. You're my skill remit.
I'm realizing just how tough life was for them.
It's what I came here to do, to explore what the 49ers went through, and this would have been a good day for them. They would have got enough food for a week, and that's what I'm here to do, to learn what it's like, and it's a strange feeling.
This is the cat that most people spend big money for.
Oh, it's just weird, it's just so warm.
This could be my only chance to kill something so rich in protein. I need to make it last. The 49ers dried their meat by a fire. It's a centuries-old Native American technique for preserving.
The positioning of the spit is crucial. You don't want it to cook, you want it to dry.
It's called jerky, from the Inca word for dried meat, jerky, and can keep for years.
As this fire goes down to embers, hopefully the air will be room temperature.
Jerky was a perfect source of protein for the pioneers, and it will be for me, even if it takes all night to dry it out. I've now got food, and I'm gonna need it. Like Manly, I've
no idea how much further I have to go or how much tougher my journey to California will become.
I've never done it in time.
But first, I'll be facing the true hardships of America's driest, hottest desert.
A few kilometers this way is Death Valley.
As far as Manly knew, no pioneers had ever made it through Death Valley. Now, the 49ers were going to try. I intend to do the same. As an endurance athlete, I've got huge respect for the courageous California Gold Rush pioneers on their brutal trek across America in 1849.
Whole families took on this route hoping to strike gold, but had absolutely no idea of the hardships ahead.
Among them was William Manley, a 29-year-old hunter who left Wisconsin for California dreaming of what he called the yellow dust. Manley's shortcut down Utah's Green River had failed. His only choice was to continue on foot, but it led him to Death Valley, North America's most inhospitable place. I want to experience how it felt for Manley as he struck out into the unknown in search of an escape route. With two families and four young children. They'd been struggling through the desert for weeks. Gold was now a low priority. By this point, they were dreaming of great lakes full of water.
49ers would have been tired, dehydrated, hungry, and a scene like this for them would have been a crushing blow.
Gold fields lay due west over the sheer Panamint Mountains. Manley knew the families would never make it across. So he risked his own life in the hope of finding a way out for everyone.
The sun just beats down on you and it's over midday yet, so haven't reached the hottest part of the day.
I failed to find the dirty puddles of water that saved Manley's life. I've got a fresh supply of jerky, so I'm not faced with the same desperate fight for food. Dehydrated and hungry, Manley was now in serious trouble. Just trudging through the sand wastes valuable water and energy.
So as your breathing rate goes up, you're losing water. And also, if your breathing rate goes up, your heart rate goes up. So you're burning energy as well. This is one brutal, brutal environment.
Manley was fighting for survival. No closer to finding a way out. Manley didn't know it, but he'd just reached the lowest point in North America. It's so dry here that surface water quickly evaporates, leaving just a layer of salt.
This place really plays with your mind. It's, aside from the beating sun and the temperature, my mind is telling me I'm walking on snow, but it is a massive salt field. There's no easy way out. It's just a very surreal, hostile environment.
It just sucks water from your body. And the 49ers were now running out of food. Manley had no choice but to leave the two families and their four children and go for help. He took John Rogers with him, this 27-year-old butcher was one of the strongest of the group. So tomorrow, I'm going to do the journey that Manny and Rogers did and see if I can make it out of Death Valley. The family's camped at a small spring, but were completely reliant on Manny and Rogers finding help and returning to Death Valley.
Makes me realise a couple of things. Firstly, I'm incredibly lucky to be able to sleep outside in a fantastic temperature, looking up at a sky so big and so full of stars. There isn't the same pressure on me to do it as there was on them, because they had to survive themselves and rescue other people. So it's going to be interesting, and hopefully I can keep a positive mindset in an environment that is not conducive to making you feel very positive.
I want to understand how Manny and Rogers escaped from Death Valley on their rescue mission. Today, I'll be finding out. No one knows the exact route they took, but I know they went west, right over the Panamints.
Right, Al.
Okay.
Manny and Rogers set off with limited water. I'll take just 3 litres, but bushcraft expert Ross Bowyer claims I'll need double that. I need to know how to find a fresh, safe supply.
How do I go about making it drinkable?
If it's dirty, you're going to need to get rid of all that sediment where the viruses and the cysts can hide, and then boil it.
Okay.
If you boil it straight away, you're not killing the viruses in there because they're protected by the sediment.
Rationing my water is going to be crucial.
After sunrise, but it's already beating down. I don't want to go too fast because I'll start sweating too much.
The climb's gradual to start with, but leaving the foothills, my attempt to summit the Panamints is going badly wrong. Too steep and too dangerous for me to climb. It's taken me over an hour just to retrace my steps and get back to this position.
It's taken me an awful lot longer than I planned. That's because, similar to Manny and Rogers, I've never met, and what I thought was the best way up turned out to be a full summit, and I got to a point where if I went up anymore, I knew I wouldn't be able to get down, and I wasn't sure if I'd be able to get up any further.
I still don't know how far it is to the top, or where my next supply of water is going to come from.
This now is the calm before the storm.
If I lose my footing on this loose rock, I've no idea how far I'll slide or what injuries I'll sustain. Manly couldn't give up. As he later wrote, his greatest fear was that women and children would choke and die, and he'd be powerless to help them.
shed for the Panamint. Hopefully this time I won't get over this and be faced by something more severe and realise the only way forward is to go back down. But I'll stop for a drink, of which will pretty much be my last drink, so hopefully there'll be something the other side.
After 7 hours, I'm out of water. More than a century and a half after Manny and Rogers set out on their rescue mission, I too have summited the Panamints, 2 kilometres above the valley floor.
It's further than it looks that. For myself this morning, I didn't think it was going to take as long as it has. I haven't got a watch on, but the sun is now there, and it was kind of over there. So it's middle of the afternoon, I imagine. I haven't got that long of sunlight left to find a bit of water. Although from the bit of the valley I can see on the other side of the Panamint, doesn't look that dissimilar to Death Valley.
Manly had read about a valley with a beautiful meadow of 1,000 acres, green as a thick carpet of grass. The reality is more desert, as far as the eye can see.
At least anywhere from here is down, and hopefully some water.
I've escaped from Death Valley and can see the first signs of vegetation. It must mean there's water.
Vegetation out.
It's the first water I've seen all day. Hundreds of pioneers died during the gold rush after drinking from stagnant pools.
So I guess it would depend on how thirsty you were as to whether you're prepared to take a risk of this being relatively free of infection.
Most 49ers knew that boiling water made it safer to drink. Sediment can protect viruses, so I'm going to filter it as well.
That sediment there is what came out of the water, and then, to be honest, I probably would have taken the risk and just boiled it.
Water is essential in desert conditions, especially when eating dried meat.
I've had a bit of a suck on it already.
Yeah.
And it's... Man.
Off to the spring. Yeah, I'll just leave you to it.
Thanks very much.
No worries.
Come and get the shrimp.
I've no choice but to repeat the whole process. I can't live without water. In his quest for gold, Manly was heading ever deeper into the unknown. For me, that's going to be the toughest challenge yet.
A century and a half on, I'm going to have to get my mind into a different place than it's been before.
I'm about to discover whether I've got the mental strength to keep going into the unknown. I'm investigating one of the most inspirational accounts of America's gold rush, the heroic journey of pioneer William Manly. He covered hundreds of kilometers on foot through a landscape known Death Valley after Manly's brutal expedition. By 1850, he'd been on the trail for months. With John Rogers, Manly set out on a rescue mission. A desperate search for help for two families and their four young children stranded in Death Valley.
I don't know how Manly and Rogers did that. Every step they took, they knew they had to. They knew they had to go back again for the families. Whereas I'm not going back.
I'm wearing animal hide moccasins just as they did. But in my quest to get inside the minds of Manly and Rogers, I'm going to push myself even further than I have before. Until now, I've learned from survival experts, but I want to find out if I can fend for myself. My team will only intervene if I'm in grave danger.
My only advice to you is look past the opportunity for either food or water. But keep your eye out for the prickly pear cactus and the beaver tail cactus. Yep. Those would be good. They don't know any other sign of protein, which will probably try and run away from you.
EM for the moose.
Sounds good.
Lovely.
In 1849, detailed mapping of Western America was virtually non-existent. I know the relates to my west, but have no idea how far away. I only have the sun to guide me.
What the 49ers had was no map, no knowledge of anything being out here, and no one supporting them at all. So, they're in a totally different situation. It's just that a century and a half on, I'm having to get my mind into a different place than it's been before. And I definitely couldn't have coped what they had to do.
The families waiting in Death Valley were camped by a groundwater spring. On their rescue mission, Manly and Rogers had to find water as they went. I'll do the same, but it's risky. A man can only survive 3 days without water. Into my solo trek, yet again I'm on salt. There's no sign of water. The heat is sapping my energy.
My amateur meteorology tells me it's after midday by the position of the sun over in the west. The fact I'm pretty knackered and the fact that it's really hot.
My biggest enemy is dehydration. And not knowing what's ahead is playing on my mind.
Summit I've got to, there's been another one waiting for me, and I can't imagine what that did to their spirits. Every time we think, okay, we're going to be close to the sea, we're going to be close to the water, we can get back and rescue the families we've come to save, and then there's another hill. I dread to think what that would have done to their spirit in terms of are they going to survive, but also that in the moment, you know, how are we going to make the next hour, how are we going to make it through to the morning.
It's sunset. I can't walk another step. I haven't seen any water, and the thin sole of my moccasins is giving me no protection from the rough ground.
Didn't find any food or any water, but luckily I saved a little bit. But I think I might be using that to particularly my feet, as they are so sore. Be good news, big mister.
I can put up with the pain, but I can't live without water. I'll be risking my life if I fail again tomorrow. I've managed 6 hours sleep, but it's water that I really need.
Vegetation's definitely changing this morning. At least there's a sign that things are changing, and that's what Manny and Rogers would have seen and appreciated as well. I think I found some beaver tail cactus.
It's the first food I've seen in over 24 hours, but to quote Manly, first began to be something terrible to endure.
I have a meal on a self-made fire, which hopefully I'll coincide with purifying water. Well, I haven't seen much sign of that yet.
It's hot, it's dry, the sun is so fierce. Hundreds of desperate pioneers died from thirst in these blistering conditions. I don't plan to share their fate.
Oh, as you can see, there is some water. Although, it doesn't look that clean. Clean the spines off the wild beaver cactus.
That's quite slimy. An undercooked potato. Spat it out, and I'm going back for more. And if I was one of the 49ers and had fought my way day after day out of Death Valley over the Panamints, I think this is pretty damn good.
By following the water to a river, a lake, or the sea, Manny and Rogers hoped to find help for the stranded families.
Oh yeah, baby. Manny and Rogers saw that, they would have filled their boots. That's great. You're going Manny and Rogers for the moment, I'm just pleased with it.
Manny and Rogers battled for 6 months across over 3,000 kilometers of unknown, hostile wilderness. Over the last few days, I've got to the heart of their epic ordeal, and I realized just how mentally tough they must have been.
I've seen plenty of lakes in my time. I'd be lying if I said I've been any gladder to see any of them than this one. And this is only a snapshot of what the 49ers went through.
The rescue mission took 25 days, but finally Manly and Rogers led the families and their children out of the desert alive, crying, goodbye Death Valley.
They had no way of knowing how far they'd gone, where they had to go to. No one had been that way before, so they were doing it blind for the first time, and how to do that and keep a positive mindset. Unbelievable. Don't make them out of the east.
Manly's inspirational journey was far from over. He eventually went on to find gold, then wrote an account of his epic journey that made the Death Valley 49ers true legends of the West.
I came here to tread in the footsteps of 49ers. I've done bits of what Manny and Rogers did. And I sit here, a broken man.